really what I want to tell you about today is one of humanity's great artistic inventions, a musical language from Europe that has pervaded for centuries and been assimilated into many different genres. One that's capable of expressing a wide range of expressions from humor to wit to pathos. One that inevitably changed the course of music history, much like the advent of, say, perspective and painting. So the goals of this project are threefold. One is to distill the characteristics of tonality of the musical language in question into a few essential principles that we can understand. Another one is to consider why it has pervaded and why it has persisted for multiple centuries and has spread to a number of genres, and we'll do this by looking at different genres. And a third one is to figure out how music works as a result of its structure, using the tonal language as a case study for it. So let's get into it. Let's look at some of the essential principles which underlie tonality. I call these axioms because I state them to be true without proving them. It's the definition of an axiom. So one axiom in particular of the tonal system is that it divides the octave into 12 discrete pitches, creating what is called the chromatic scale. You have the definition, the precise definition of an octave there, but basically it's just any the interval between any pitch and another one, which is either double or half its frequency. So if you just consider octaves in the abstract, before any sort of human organization of this pitch space in between them, there's no way to break it up naturally, right? It's a continuous pitch space. Just take this, whoa, right? So there's no discrete pitches there. In order to make music, a useful thing to do would be to break it up so that we have some discrete pitches to work with. So what we have first is continuous pitch space. You could consider this circle as an octave. Circle has an infinite number of vertices, so nothing discrete. And then tonality imposes a discretization onto it, specifically a 12-tone one. That's why we have 12 note names. And it looks like this. So that's a discrete pitch space, which I'm representing by a dodecagon, because we have 12 note names. So that's one axiom of tonality. Let's look at another one. Tonality chooses 24 what are called diatonic scales from the chromatic scale for general use. Diatonic scale has a kind of a complicated definition, but basically it's a subset of a chromatic scale. Instead of choosing all 12, you choose a specific subset of it. And there are many ways to do this, right? It's actually 12 factorial or some combinatorics problem. You can figure out how many ways you can choose subsets of a chromatic scale. The diatonic scale is a very specific one. Even with that imposition, there's a number of ways to create a diatonic scale. You can do the math, it's a combinatorics problem. A diatonic scale is a scale comprised of 5 whole steps and 2 half steps, such that the 2 half steps are maximally separated. So that means there are 7 species of diatonic scales, and since we have 12 starting pitches, we have 12 times 7 equals 84 possible distinct diatonic scales. Tonality chooses a subset of that 84 to get 24. Sounds a bit like jargon, but let's see what this looks like. So here's the chromatic scale, and let's look at what a diatonic scale looks like. Here's the chromatic scale again. And the 24 diatonic scales that tonality uses, there are 12 called major scales and 12 called minor scales. So here, for example, is a C major scale. You see, it looks like kind of this asymmetrical polygon that's inside this 12-gon. And it's comprised specifically of whole step, half step, whole step, whole step, whole step, half step. So since we can start on any of the 12 pitches, we have 12 major scales, and it looks like this. Here's a C major, C sharp major, D major, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, all the way to B. Now we also have 12 minor scales, which have a different intervallic construction, also on your definition list. And that one is whole step, half step, whole step, whole step, half step, whole step, whole step. Remember, this is axiomatic, so I'm not gonna tell you how this came about. There is a long, complicated history, but it's beyond the scope of this. So here's the C minor scale, and again, since we have 12 different pitches we can start on, that creates the second 12 of our set of 24. So here's C minor, C sharp minor, D minor, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, until we get to D minor. That creates our 24 diatonic scales that are used in the tonal system. Let's keep going. What's another axiom of the tonal system? One is that tonality adheres to a set of syntactical rules that govern the usage of notes and chords in any key. A syntactical rule is any imposition of order between two notes or chords. So what that means is that given a certain key, we can say that one chord can go to another chord, represented by a single arrow. But say that that chord is not syntactically allowed to go to the previous one, so then we represent it like this. Chord B cannot go to chord A. What about two chords that are interchangeable, that can go in either direction? You can use a double-edged arrow. Chord C and chord D can precede or succeed after one another. That's all the syntactical rule is. I won't give you a lot of examples because it could fill a textbook, but any syntactical rule that imposes some order on tonality looks of this form. So we've covered a couple of the axioms. There are more, but for the purposes of this presentation, let's go on and see what we might develop or extend from these axioms. And this is what I call a proposition. A proposition, as you have on your definition sheet, is not something that is asserted to be true, but something that is provable by axioms. So I can demonstrate why these propositions exist, the logical extensions of the axioms. So let's look at a particular proposition of tonality. One is that a key can be identified by elements which need not include the key note. So if you think about this, this is not necessarily intuitive. You know, in some languages or in some systems, the only way you can state something is by stating it explicitly. Take like arithmetic, if you're trying to say six, yeah, you can say 3 plus 3, but there's no other way to say it, right? You can make a number of constructions to imply it, but in the tonal system, for a specific reason, which I'll prove to you, you can state the pitch without actually stating it explicitly. The proof is because of the asymmetrical layout of the diatonic scale. So we already saw what a diatonic scale looked like. It was this funny irregular polygon. Let's look again and actually hear it and see why this asymmetry allows for what we call orientability. So here's the chromatic scale again. And let's look at a particular diatonic scale. Let's say the C major scale. And I will show you what it looks like and you'll also hear it. Sounds really nice. Doesn't sound like something asymmetrical and funny looking like that. So let's look at something that is symmetrical. Here's another chromatic scale, and let's look at a non-diatonic scale, say a C whole tone scale, which is generated purely by whole tones, so no juxtaposition of half tones and whole steps and half steps. Here it is. Looks much more symmetrical, but it's not nearly as nice a scale to work with. The reason being, and I'll show you this, is because if you have an asymmetrical scale and you play a subset of it, because it is asymmetrical, you can figure out the rest of it. With a symmetrical scale, if you play a subset of it, you don't know where you are. If I were to play you a couple of these tones and tell me, is this an F-sharp whole tone scale, a C whole tone scale, a D whole tone scale, you won't be able to tell me, because it's symmetrical everywhere. If I play you a couple of these notes, you will be able to tell me what the key is, because it's asymmetrical. Let's actually demonstrate this. You can figure out the next note even though I never played it. Let's try the same thing with the whole tone scale. Which whole tone scale is that? Is it D, E, F sharp? Any takers? Yes, it's an F sharp whole tone scale, that's right. Also a B flat whole tone scale. Because it's symmetrical, we can't figure out which scale it is. So asymmetry accounts for orientability. Let's look at another proposition that results from axioms. Another one is that the function of a note or chord is determined by context. So given any particular note or chord, say a C major chord, you cannot tell me what key we're in or what that chord is functioning as, absent context. It's because that chord exists in a number of different keys. So let's see what that looks like. So again, this has to do with the asymmetrical scalar layout and the common syntactical progressions. So here's the chromatic scale, and let's look at a C major chord. It looks like this. Can anyone tell me what key we're in?
C major.
Well, it could be. So here's what a C major scale looks like. And you can see that the vertices are coincident. So yes, this chord could exist in C major. But it could also exist in F major. See, the vertices are also coincident with the F major scale. It could also exist in G major. It could also exist in a number of minor keys. So how do we know what key we're in? We do not, absent further context. As such, in each of these different keys, the C major chord, which is the same sonority, functions differently. Let's see what we mean. So in the key of C major, a C major chord is set to function as a tonic chord, the chord that the key is named after. And a sample progression would sound like this. The C major chord flanks a dominant chord, and the C major is functioning as a tonic chord. Say we're in F major, then C major is no longer functioning as a tonic chord, despite being the exact same sonority. Here's a sample progression. Same chord, if I were to stop the audio right there, you wouldn't be able to tell me we're in F major. It's only the next chord which contextualizes it. It could also function in G major, where it's called a subdominant function chord. Here's what that sounds like. Again, if I were to stop it right after the C major chord, you would not be able to tell me we were in G major. It's only the next two chords which retrospectively contextualize it. So this is another proposition. Now that we've seen a couple of propositions and developed some theory, let's see how this might apply in music. So let's listen to this Radiohead song and see what happens. So the beginning seems to make sense. This is a perfectly well-formed syntactical progression in C minor. If we stopped it after the first chord, yes, I agree, we'd not be able to tell what key it is. But all the chords that are diatonic to C minor, which means they exist in C minor, retrospectively contextualize the first seven bars as a phrase in C minor. But then we get the C sharp half diminished seventh chord, which doesn't exist in C minor. We don't know what's going on. We need more context. Let's check out the bridge section and see if it helps clarify something. Mysterious C sharp half diminished seventh chord. Now we're no longer in C minor, now we're in D minor, and we see a 5-1 progression in D minor. So that C sharp half diminished seventh chord, we might start to get a clue for what it's about. C sharp half diminished seventh chord is diatonic to a D minor scale, so maybe it's a way of trying to get to D minor but failing to do so. In the bridge section, we get there but only for one bar. Let's see what happens at the end in the coda. Ended on that C sharp half diminished seventh chord, we now realize that when it first came, it was not any sort of subversion of expectation or something that was a substitute for some kind of C minor chord. In fact, the whole point of the song was this chord. You can consider the song as being in C minor and trying to achieve D minor, but ultimately failing to do so. We get to it in the bridge just for one bar, and then we immediately go away, going to the subdominant of G minor. Every phrase that ends with this C sharp half diminished seventh chord represents this limbo phase. We've tried to get out of C minor into D minor, but we're stuck in this phase that does not allow us to get there. It is only by considering the retrospective action of the whole piece can we figure out the function of this chord. This is an excellent demonstration of the proposition that the function of a note or chord only makes sense in context. So that's all the music I have for you today. You might be wondering, you know, why didn't I choose something like Bach, Mozart, or Beethoven to demonstrate a latent possibility of the tonal system, right? These are undisputed masters of the idiom. Well, that is precisely the point, that the language is so rich that you can see its assimilation from genres as disparate as Euroclassical 17th century music and 21st century British rock music. I think that's a testament to the versatility of the tonal system.